Sup, you beautiful bastards. Hope you've had a fantastic Monday. Welcome back to the Philip DeFranco Show. And a quick note before we get started. If you like diving into the news in a place that you trust, you want to see more, I highly, highly, highly recommend today you go to youtube.com/roguerocket. Go subscribe to make it even easier. I'll include a link in the top description. Go over there, subscribe to the channel. There are no videos live on it yet. We're going to be launching it very soon. We've obviously been testing on this channel over the past year with the morning videos and weekend videos, trying out different styles, different video lengths, different angles. If you follow us in the other places, you know that Rogue Rocket's been a lot more active on other social media platforms, but we're finally now feeling very good, very confident about it. So go to that channel, go subscribe, and be on the lookout. But with that said, for this video, hit that like button, otherwise I'm gonna throat punch you. And with that said, let's just jump into it. The first thing we're gonna talk about today is just something very brief, but it's something I find important to do every year. In the States, you know that obviously I'm filming this on Memorial Day, a day where we raise awareness, where we honor the men and women who have made the ultimate sacrifice for this country. And I've said a variety of things on Memorial Day, but it ultimately boils down to just one thing. Thank you. I know that there are so many others that watch a show that are so incredibly thankful, have said thank you, have honored. But what I would also ask, and it's a little bit of homework, is after today's show, I'm gonna include a link in the description. Go to this tweet thread that was started by the US Army. They asked, how has serving impacted you? And thousands of people responded, and it's something that I think can be hard to look through, but I think is incredibly important we look through. Because these stories often serve as these dark reminders of why we should be so thankful for these people who have served their country. And it shines a light on one of the invisible costs of war that happens after the fact. At a time where we as a country need to do far better for them. Yeah, that's just something I wanted to hit on at the top of this show. And then in some industry news, we had the beacon of the anti-bullying movement here on YouTube, Jake Paul, at the center of a new story. And as far as the reason, according to this Metro headline, YouTuber Jake Paul sparks backlash as he advertises for intern that will be paid with, quote, fun, not money. And from that, it appears that this is the continuation of a debate that we've seen online where promo is being used instead of pay. But I will say, just taking a second to look into the situation, it might not be as clear cut. When I say clear cut, I mean, for example, you had Tana Mojo in the news recently because she said that she wanted services in exchange for promotion. She was looking for someone to do her makeup more often, writing looking for someone available a lot, flexible, willing to accept mainly promo as compensation. Although with Jake Paul's post, which has now been deleted, he writes, please read if you're an aspiring music producer slash engineer, with a screenshot reading, we are in need of a full-time in-house producer slash engineer who will mainly act as an engineer for us. This will be an internship position and will provide you with real-life experience, connections, exposure, and a whole lot of fun. So I will say, in the effort to be fair, it should be noted, at no point does it say unpaid, although I will say the way that it's worded, experience, exposure, connections, it seems unpaid, which is important not only morally or public perception-wise, but legally. There are legal requirements and restrictions when it comes to unpaid internships, but that's a legal aspect of it, and as of right now, we do not have the specifics. As far as the public reaction, there was a lot of outrage as well as just kind of ridicule. YouTuber, podcaster Ethan Klein writing, full-time in-house producer who is also an intern. Bro, you can afford to pay him, you cyberbully. An Irish musician by the name of Bri responded with a screenshot of an email. OMG, hi Jake, I am engineer from Ireland and would like work with you for exposure. Mine interests include getting shafted by rich boys. Please write back. And in general, the response was, man, you're a multi-millionaire. But people are saying you have all of this and you can't even pay for a music producer. And in general, my opinion and my position on this is if someone creates something or they do something for you without you asking for it and they send it to you or they show it to you, then yeah, you can promote that person for this thing that they did on their own. But I'm also now personally against unpaid internships. For example, our company policy is we have no internships whatsoever. We just hire and pay somebody. I personally think that's what we should see more of in our industry as these companies grow, especially a company that seems to be doing incredibly well. That said, to be fair to the other side of this debate, there is no doubt that exposure from this guy, whether you like him or not, is valuable. And so I imagine there's not gonna be a shortage of people willing to eat shit for a while in the hopes that they can then, you know, boost past it. And that's not Jake Paul specific. Like, my current policy of not hiring internships, that is in the face of having the knowledge that there's probably hundreds, if not thousands of you watching right now that are incredibly capable that would be willing to do an unpaid internship. And so then you kind of have this question of, well, are people getting angry about a situation where someone's willingly putting themselves into this position, right? To say maybe no pay or little pay, you have people being outraged on their behalf, or no, it's actually still much larger than that. Because if you have an industry where this sort of relationship is not vilified, that it actually makes it worse for other people who have that profession because people go, well, no, look over here. There's no pay, there's just promo. And so it could be argued that it hurts the industry and a profession as a whole. But that's a story, and of course, I pass the question off to you. What are your thoughts on this? Because I am very interested because two different versions of myself have two different opinions on this. I, as an employer now, am against it, but if I was an up-and-comer in the industry, I would 100% take that and live out of my car. But yeah, let me know what you're thinking in those comments down below. But from that, I want to share some stuff I love to today and today in awesome, brought to you by SeatGeek. And SeatGeek, if you don't know, is the fantastic ticket app that takes confusion out of buying tickets for all kinds of live events, from concerts to comedy shows to sporting events. They put all the tickets in one place, they give them a 0 to 100 score so you know if you're getting a good deal or not. I've got the app on my phone, and it is by far the easiest way to shop for tickets to whatever, whether it be a last minute date idea or something down the road. For me, it's personally kind of a last minute thing, whether I want to spice up a weekend by taking my son to a game, or a last minute Mother's Day was probably the last time I used it. I got my wife really good seats for Ariana Grande, which, actually, on that note, for you and maybe my wife, Father's Day is around the corner as well. I don't know if it's because I'm getting older, but I think definitely experiences are amazing gifts. But with that said, if you want to snag something for yourself, or maybe it's a gift, just go to SeatGeekPhil.com, and then make sure you use code Phil, because they'll give you $20 off your first ticket purchase. Check it out, use the code, save, and enjoy. And the first bit of awesome is we had Charles Cornell, who, if you don't know, I started following him on Instagram. He does piano covers, but instead of it being of a regular song, it's of usually viral clips. He's done piano covers of apology videos, and this most recent one is the And I Oop. Definitely check that out if you're looking for something kind of weird that'll make you smile. Then we got a teaser for season 10 of Archer. Lonely Island gave us a little piece of the unauthorized Bash Brothers experience, which is actually up in its full 30 minutes of glory on Netflix right now. I would describe it as interesting and unique. Then James Corden got the cast of Aladdin to do a crosswalk production of the movie. It is a weird, fantastic, awkward time. Side note, quickie review of the new Aladdin. As an adult, I thought it was kind of okay. I enjoyed it. I was mainly glad I got to experience it because Naomi Scott has an amazing voice and I never knew. That said, for parents out there, I will say my son loved it, although on that note, I've noticed in like the last 5 movies I've taken him to at the movie theater, he's always ended it with, "That was the best movie ever!" But yeah, worth a matinee if you got kids. And if you want to see the full versions of everything I just shared, the secret link of the day, really anything at all, links as always are in the description down below. And then let's talk about interesting and important updates on a story that we covered earlier this month. Now, as you might recall, on the 13th, we talked about a San Francisco journalist whose house was raided by police after he refused to reveal a source. Brian Carmody, a freelance journalist, had provided some news outlets with the unreleased death report of former public defender Jeff Adachi. And when Carmody would not reveal his source for his report, police raided his home and took computers, cell phones, and other electronics. And in a statement after that search, a police spokesperson said it was, quote, a step in the process of investigating a potential case of obstruction of justice, along with the illegal distribution of confidential police material. Now, while some supported the police trying to get to the bottom of whoever was leaking information, many people felt that this violated the legal protections for journalists. And in California, this is often called the Shield Law, but it's actually Article 1, Section 2 of California's Constitution that says that a journalist cannot be held in contempt for refusing to disclose a source. Now, last week, on Tuesday, San Francisco Police Chief William Scott tried to justify the raid, saying that legal experts have said that the exception to the Shield Law is if a journalist had committed a crime, and adding,
we do believe that Mr. Carmody committed crime, and that's what we've been investigating. We believe that early on.
Then, a few days later, we saw California Governor Gavin Newsom release a statement criticizing the police's actions, saying, San Francisco prides itself as a place that defends civil liberties. Freedom of the press is an essential part of our democracy. Journalists should be able to do their jobs, including working with confidential sources, without becoming targets themselves. And then this last Friday, Chief Scott changed course and apologized for the search in an interview with the San Francisco Chronicle, saying, I'm sorry that this happened. I'm sorry to the people of San Francisco. I'm sorry to the mayor. We have to fix it. We know there were some concerns in that investigation, and we know we have to fix it. Adding that he was concerned that some of the search warrants did not adequately identify Carmody as a journalist. And in an official statement released on Friday, he hit harder on that point, saying, I am specifically concerned by a lack of due diligence by department investigators in seeking search warrants and appropriately addressing Mr. Carmody's status as a member of the news media. With Scott also saying that their investigations related to the case were being handed over to independent agencies at the request of Mayor London Breed. But that is not where this ends, because on Saturday, in a letter to members, the San Francisco Police Officers Association President Tony Montoya pushed back on Scott's claims and called for him to step down, saying, Chief Scott not only followed every twist and turn of the investigation, but he knew every element of the investigation, directed the investigation, and has clearly either come down with the most debilitating case of amnesia, or is flat out not telling the truth about his direct involvement and the horribly flawed direction he gave to find the leak of the police report. And adding, in either case, it is time for Chief Scott to go. Man, if only Montoya would actually tell us what he really felt. Now, on the opposite side of this, Police Commissioner President Robert Hirsch and Vice President Damali Taylor wrote a letter in support of the chief's decision, saying, Chief Scott did what is rare for police chiefs. He apologized to the citizens of San Francisco. He did so completely and unequivocally. That is the mark of a leader. And we also saw a police department spokesperson say in a statement, Chief Scott has made it abundantly clear that transparency and accountability are paramount in this criminal investigation. That is why SFPD is seeking an independent and partial third party to take over the original criminal case. And as far as the opinion of the person at the center of this story, right, Carmody, in response to Scott's apology, Carmody tweeted out a statement from his lawyer saying that they are pleased, but adding, there needs to be real reform in the department to ensure that the SFPD respects the First Amendment and the independence of a free press. As far as my opinion about this situation, I am glad to see the kind of a about face from Scott, but at the same time, it's incredibly hard to dismiss the fact that it looks like Scott was like, yes, we're doing the right thing. Actually, I think those guys messed up. I was concerned about it, right? And everything starts getting worded in a way that seems like he's trying to separate himself, but once again, he said, we.
Yeah, we do believe that Mr. Carmody committed crime, and that's what we've been investigating. We believe that early on.
So why would you talk about exceptions to the SHIELD law because someone's a journalist, and then later release a statement about how you were concerned that investigators didn't properly label Carmody as a journalist? I don't know. I understand that nobody's perfect. I think that we should hope that people will own their mistakes, apologize. But this to me, and once again, this is more of kind of a feeling, right? We all receive information differently. This to me seems less of owning and being responsible for it and more of kind of trying to save your ass. And the only thing that keeps me from definitively feeling like that is the prospect of a third party being involved in looking through this situation. But ultimately, that's a story as it is now, a little bit of my personal takeaway on it, and I pass the question off to you. What are your thoughts on that? And then finally, let's talk about the huge news coming out of the European Union. Over the weekend, the European Union held elections for the 751 seats in its parliament. Those seats represent over 512 million people in 28 countries, and it is the only time Europeans directly vote for the people holding office in the EU. Because outside of this, they're kind of choosing indirectly by voting in their own national elections, and those officials then choose who represents them in other parts of the EU government. There's a whole video that I'll link to down below that really dives deep into it. But here, what we're looking at is the direct chance for the opinions and the mindset of Europeans to really be heard. And this election ended up being one of the biggest in recent years, with just over 50% of eligible voters turning out to vote. When you look back to 2014, that is a massive jump, because in 2014, just 42% of the voters showed up. And this year is actually the highest turnout since 1994. But that said, what are some of the big takeaways from the election result? Well, votes are still being counted, but the EU has come out with some projections based on votes counted so far. And overall, the parliament has become more fragmented and polarized. The biggest change is that the so-called Grand Coalition lost over 70 seats in their majority in parliament. They were made up of two groups, one from center-left, one from center-right, and their lost seats went to groups that were either further left or further right. And we'll start off with seats that went further right. So two countries that a lot of people were paying attention to because of their large populist movements. You had the UK and France. In the UK, we saw Nigel Farage's Brexit party take about 32% of the vote, which is actually almost the same amount both the Labour and Liberal Democrats parties got combined. It's also a lot for a party that didn't even exist 4 months ago and votes on one issue. Brexit. Although it is important to note here that most of the won seats came from his former party, the Independence Party. And for many, this win highlighted how dissatisfied people were with the Brexit process. But as far as where the population in the UK stands on it, it still seems incredibly divided. You have experts saying that in the UK, when you kind of combine all of the parties and positions, pro-Remain actually has more votes. But Remain doesn't really have a figurehead, whereas Brexit, they just look to the person that has the most name value and they go, yes, that is where my vote is. But it's still a new situation, a fresh situation. You have a lot of people claiming victories in one facet or another, and right now we're just gonna have to wait to see what happens there. Then we move to France, where the election has been described by outlets like the New York Times as, quote, an embarrassing blow to the party of President Emmanuel Macron. As far as why, it's because his party, Republic on the Move, lost to the far-right National Rally Party, which is the party of former presidential candidate Marine Le Pen. Now granted, it was not a big loss, the difference was barely 1%, but the party is getting around 23 and 22% of the vote. Additionally, Macron's party is part of a coalition in parliament that ended up winning votes elsewhere, meaning that even though Republic on the Move lost in France, they might actually end up being more powerful in parliament than they were before. Because while Le Pen's party by itself got more than any other individual party, and Le Pen had hoped for a populist wave in France and across Europe, that ended up not actually happening in France. But in other parts of Europe, we did see some big wins, specifically in Poland and Hungary. In Hungary, the far-right party won over 50% of the vote, which was a huge win for their leader, Viktor Orban. We also saw strong showings in Italy and Sweden for the right wing. And while at various times you've had the right-wing French, Hungarian, and Italian parties saying that they hope to make an anti-EU bloc in parliament, it's unclear if that's actually going to happen. Because even with all of these wins, the hope for this populist wave ended up being somewhat of a populist ripple. Because across Europe overall, these parties only went from 20% of the EU parliament to 25%. But with all that said, that brings us now to the left-wing parties, especially the various Green parties. Like their right-wing counterparts, they were also big winners in this recent election, and they took seats from the centrist Grand Coalition. They did very well in Germany, Portugal, across the Nordic countries, and even won seats in Ireland, where they had never won before. They also did well in France and Sweden, which are two countries that also had populist parties do very well. And you know, across Europe, many of their votes came from young voters who were dissatisfied with center-left parties. And in general, it appears that European politics are becoming far more polarized. Now, with all of that said, there of course is the question of, after everything is done, what does European Parliament now look like? Well, even though everyone's talking about the wins the left-wing and the right-wing parties had, they're still relatively small wins. Overall, the Green parties only won around 17 more seats, while the right-wing parties won around 34 more. The biggest winners were actually the alliance of Macron's party, which is the ALDE. They probably won 40 seats, they're liberal centrist, not a far-left party, and I say probably, because official counts have yet to be made, so this is subject to change a little bit. And so despite all of the big news, the parties that make up the Grand Coalition still have control. Together, it looks like they'll still hold 326 seats out of 751, meaning that they'll just need to work with one or two of the smaller parties to keep their rule. And so what we're going to be seeing over this next week or two is that we're going to see talks and negotiations from various parties trying to form a majority coalition. And then that coalition will get to decide the EU's top job. But for now, we just have to wait. With that said, that of course is the story. I'd love to know everyone's thoughts on it. But specifically, if you are in the EU, I'd love to know your thoughts on this last election. Are you happy with what you're seeing? Are you hating what you're seeing? Why not? Let me know what you're thinking in those comments down below. And that's where we're going to end today's show. And remember, if you like this video, you want to support the channel, I'd love if you took a second to hit that like button, maybe even share the video. Also, if you're new here, be sure to hit that subscribe button to make sure you don't miss these daily videos. Also, if you're not 100% filled in, over the weekend we posted a bunch of extra bonus content. You can click or tap right there to watch that right now. But with that said, of course, as always, my name's Philip DeFranco. You've just been filled in. I love yo faces, and I'll see you tomorrow.